Nicholas Jones is the next person who's going to be speaking. Nicholas is a professional dancer with the Grand Ballet of Montréal. He and his girlfriend Julia have been working with students in Kenya now for a number of years, building upon a certain very, very powerful intention to create a classical culture and an ability for these students to experience the best of the artistic discoveries of the West, and do this in a way that would allow these kids to eventually incorporate this into their own folklores, their own worldviews, their own experiences, and do this in a way which is in conjunction with the New Silk Road's appearance in Africa.
Great, thank you, Matt. I'm gonna try and rush through this. I did this all this morning, and it's pretty dense. So if I'm too much in the computer sometimes, you'll know why. I'm following a script. I'll try and improvise at certain moments, but yeah, I'm going to stick to this because I want to get in as much information as possible. So I'm going to start with today an introduction of China, just a very short one. And thanks to Sean, he's already set the platform like perfectly for me. But I'm going to actually reiterate a few of the points that you made and that brilliant video you showed us at the beginning of the GDP growth and the PPP growth as well, really highlights perfectly what I'm about to say. And I'm gonna start at a more recent period, 1978, when Deng Xiaoping came into the Chinese government, or came to power. And Mr. Xiaoping is considered to be the original architect of the modern China that we see today. And he led a series of economic reforms that revolutionized the nation and brought about a level of prosperity never before seen in China. His reforms focused on rejuvenating many industries such as agriculture, science, technology, and also a cultural shift away from communism towards a more modern society based in what Sean was saying, towards more Confucianism ideology, and a grander vision of what the future could be. It's because of this that Mr. Xiaoping it's because of Mr. Xiaoping that we are left with such incredible cities that you see here, such as Shenzhen, which in 1974 numbered only around 20 to 30,000 people. This is, believe it or not, Shenzhen in 1974. Forgive the bad quality of the picture. I mean, the pixels, you know, it was a picture taken in 1974. So you can, you know, that was the state of the technology at the time as well, which is also something represented by China today with the unveiling of 5G and such technologies. But yeah, this is what it was. And I have another picture here. This is a common street in Shenzhen. It was a small fishing town, but today Shenzhen has a population of 12.5 million people just 44 decades later. And this is all thanks to the creation of, under Deng Xiaoping, he started a policy of creating special economic zones, like SEZs is the abbreviation, and these were major economic reforms in China. Shenzhen was not the only case where this idea of SEZs was implemented, as other cities have also witnessed huge growth, both population-wise and in the economic numbers, and later on you'll realize that those two numbers are actually very firmly integrated and work in tandem with one another. Some others worth mentioning, some other cities are Zhuhai, which is just across the bay from Shenzhen. It's part of the Greater Bay Region. You've got Tianjin as well, which is close to Beijing, which will very soon become part of the Jingjinji megacity planned by China's government, which will have a population close to 100 million people. It will far outweigh any city in the world in terms of numbers and in terms of technological capabilities. We also have Guangzhou, which in 1978, the year Deng Xiaoping came to power, had only 1.8 million people. Today has 13 million people and is a beautiful modern city. So as we can see here, this is Shenzhen today. So, you know, we see very clearly what's happened to Shenzhen, both in growth of economy, technology, science, numbers of people living there in harmony, let's not forget, because we are also talking about poverty alleviation today. The topic of my, sorry, I forgot to mention, the topic of this presentation is A New Hope for Africa, based on the new paradigm which is being presented by China, the Belt and Road Initiative. So yeah, it is through the realization of these SEZs, as well as other measures that have been taken, that China has managed to decrease the number of people living in poverty by an astounding number, and in record time for any nation that has ever existed on this planet. Such measures include massive state-funded infrastructure building benefiting the masses and their standard of living. Examples include China's incredible 30,000-kilometer high-speed rail network. Bear in mind, in 2006, there wasn't one single high-speed rail line in China. 12 years later, there's 30,000 kilometers of it. Then you have the current unveiling of 5G nationwide, which is an unveiling like that other countries cannot replicate. And already they are working on 6G. That was just announced last week. And how about China's water diversification plan called the North-South Water Transfer Project? Sorry, this is Guangzhou. This is the Opera House, which is of particular interest to me in this top left corner here. And this is inside, which replicates A Starry Night. So when the lights go out, that is, it is almost like you're watching a performance underneath the stars. This is the harmony that Guangzhou replicates between nature and city. And this is a beautiful bridge in Guangzhou as well. Moving on, the water project, the North-South Diversification Project, which China undertook and is quite possibly the largest ever infrastructure project undertaken on this planet. Ultimately, it aims to move over 40 billion cubic meters of water from the rich southern regions of China to the north, where droughts and desertification have caused problems for Beijing and other major cities. To put these projects into context, the support from the Chinese state in building these massive projects has helped pull between 750 and 800 million people out of abject poverty. And that's since 1975. And in other stats, China had 97.5% of its rural population, or 770 million people, living below the World Bank poverty line in 1978, just before Deng Xiaoping came in. According to statistics released by the World Bank, a Western institution, over the past 40 years, the number of people in China living below the international poverty line has dropped by more than 850 million. This represents 70% of the total world figure. Now, we should all take a moment to put that into context. Like, 70% of the total world figure of poverty eradication has been achieved by one nation on this planet, not the West, with all of our, you know, emotional freedoms and whatever else comes with that. Like, it's China, like none other than. This single nation has taken 1.4 billion people that were living in horrendous conditions, and instead of crying about it, actually saw it as an opportunity to empower themselves and create, you know, things like this. This is the Three Gorges Dam in the bottom right corner here. It's the largest dam in the world. It has 22, it produces 22 gigawatts of electricity. Kwao maybe later can tell you guys what that is equivalent of in terms of how many cities it can power, but more than Beijing. And this is the actual map in the bottom left corner here of the whole project. So you can see it scans all the way across China from east to west. It's quite incredible. So with, I mean, these canals, they're over thousands of kilometers long, and they've done this in under a decade. Like, it's really quite a national unifying project, and it requires the entire nation to pull together to make things like this happen. It's no small thing. Like, Britain right now in the current political climate could never achieve anything like this. We are struggling to build a 60-kilometer train underneath London as we speak. So, you know, by the time that will be finished, China will have added another 5,000 kilometers of high-speed rail to their network. So, to move on. Today, China, with most of that population who have exited poverty since, are still living with the wonderful benefits of such state reforms, is planning on defeating poverty totally by the end of next year. Currently, as we speak, or as of the end of 2018, only 1.7% of China's population still live in poverty, or as a number, roughly 16 million people. This is at the end of 2018, and we are already almost at the end of 19. And given that on average, the country is reducing the number of people in poverty by 10 million a year, China will probably reach this goal before 2020 even finishes. So now I'm going to switch over to Africa. We're going to travel a few thousand kilometers. And we need to transport ourselves to a different culture. Most people's widespread perception of Africa, or at least Westerners, deem the continent a continent of disease, poverty, conflict, and widespread suffering. This is the widespread opinion of Africa. Whenever I've done political organizing or even just with casual conversation with colleagues from work, most of us grew up in a time where Band Aid and We Are the World concerts warned of major problems with poverty, and most of us have experienced the emotional reactions of common Westerners phoning up hotlines to donate what little savings they had. But little did we know that at the time that our $2 a month would simply not come close to changing much for the largest continent on the planet with its booming population of 1.2 billion people and growing at the fastest rate on Earth. Africans, continent-wide, knew little of such initiatives or concerts and largely were unaffected by our emotional outpouring. Unfortunately, feelings will not overcome such a crime that poverty is. Be that as it may, hope would come, but not in the form of aid or charity. China's helping hand, as well as India and Japan, who have offered enormous loans to fund great infrastructure building to help these nations begin in their goal of overcoming poverty. This may come as a surprise to many people that, in fact, what Africa represents today is far different from a decade ago, let alone even 5 years ago. Africa now represents a continent of enormous potential and optimism for a new paradigm of interrelations on the continent, as well as its relations with nations outside its borders. Often overlooked and even ignored in international affairs and international politics, Africa now is becoming a force to be reckoned with, and largely thanks to one or two nations that have offered a helping hand not just recently, but throughout the multiple decades. I want to show you all a project that China helped Tanzania and Zambia start building in 1970, going on to finish here in 1975. Let me just skip through. I will have to go back. This above is called Tazara. It's an abbreviation. It's a Tanzanian-Zambian railway alliance, a railway that at a full length is 1,860 kilometers long and has opened up both countries to cultural exchanges as well as larger trade deals and people-to-people exchanges also. Interesting to note that China paid entirely for this line at the same time that they were trying to get their own people out of poverty. And I said it was 1970 that they started this. China's population, 97% of it was in poverty at the time. So as they were fighting poverty, they are providing $406 million to build a 1,800 kilometer railway in Tanzania to link it to Zambia for nothing. Today, that is the equivalent of $2.62 billion. So that railway is still alive and well. It still can be traveled on by any of us who are willing to go and take a trip. Or anybody in the country trying to get from nation to nation or transport goods or whatever it may be that you need to use these transport links for. There were no strings attached. It was simply a friendly gesture which has changed the face of both nations for the past 50 years. Now that's what I call a real helping hand, for money alone cannot help people. Only money or credit invested in the physical economy can have such a great effect and help develop the standards of living for the many and not just a few. Money alone, in the form of aid, has and will simply lead to massive rates of corruption, and the rich getting richer while the poor are left to fend for themselves. Now I want to roll on to today, and to greater and even more exciting prospects for not just Tanzania and Zambia, but pretty much every nation within Africa. I'm going to talk about a personal favorite of mine, and roll back here. It's called GERD, or that's the abbreviation for it. It's the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam. It's pretty grand. It's almost a spitting replica of the Three Gorges Dam in China. It's been faced with delays, but worry not, it's 70% complete and it's moving forward very fast. It's a very fitting name indeed when we come to realize what it is. The largest hydroelectric dam ever built in Africa, and due to be complete in 2022 after much negotiation over the use of the Nile's water resources with neighboring countries Egypt and Sudan, which just recently have been helped along by none other than President Donald Trump organizing the platform for those nations to come to the table and talk over the issues involved. The dam is being built by Cellini and Pregilo, an Italian company, at a cost of $5 billion, which is being funded half by China's Export-Import Bank and half through government bonds. It is, in fact, part of China's Belt and Road Plan and was initiated with the Chinese state's help. And it is important to note that though China is helping fund the dam, it is actually being built by an Italian company. So often we hear in Western media that all of these loans that are handed out to African nations or South American nations, like, they have to be built by Chinese workers or Chinese companies. Like, I will show you later, but I have studied this pretty minutely, and I can attest that, like, none of that is true. All of the jobs that are created, over 80% of them are African employees. So I will go through some other projects later that highlight this. But this one, for example, has created around 20,000 to 30,000 jobs within Ethiopia, just this alone, either direct or indirectly. The dam will produce 6 gigawatts of energy, while more than doubling Ethiopia's energy production capacity and making the nation an energy exporter for the region rather than importer. It has also helped create, like I said before, 20,000 to 30,000 jobs, both directly and indirectly. It currently stands 70% complete, and we wait with excitement for its completion coming in the next few years. Now, this is the kind of project which, as we can see, requires international dialogue and diplomacy put into its full use. The process has been a rigorous example of what can be achieved when many nations, both on the continent and outside, combine and collaborate to bring about a project that will empower the common people's lives for the better. Most interesting to note is that originally, believe it or not, this project was envisioned by the United States Bureau of Reclamation back in 1956, but due to a coup in the country, probably by the British Empire, all the efforts were stalled. So finally, after 40 years of silence on the project, China's Belt and Road Initiative has revived the spirit needed to get GERD off the ground, and finally concrete was laid in 2011. So we had to wait 50 years for such a brilliant idea to come to the fore, just because of a coup, actually. I mean, it's kind of crazy. Like, all those times we watched Band-Aid and We Are the World, those were the decades that came after 1950s. Well, this could have already been built by then. And you think of how many millions of children have suffered from abject poverty and disease since then. And this could have all been avoided. Like, people are walking around today thinking that there's no hope for Africa. Like, in fact, there was always hope. Like, a dam is not new technology. It's centuries old. And this could have been done ages ago. And was actually, under the United States, the beacon of liberty, freedom, and the pursuit of happiness. Was going to be implemented until, you know, outside forces interfered with the process. And, you know, here we are 50 years later, just finally achieving a national goal. But anyway, the optimism is there and it is being achieved, and it's brilliant. Another major project on the continent I want to talk about is a new railway being built in Tanzania. The Dar es Salaam. Oh, sorry, I just want to mention this building, I added it in just as another example of China's aid sometimes. This is the African Union headquarters in Ethiopia, Addis Ababa. It was built for a cost of $200 million. It was a grant. China built it as a grant, like for free. Like anybody can get a grant to go do education, like you don't pay it back. So that was the African Union headquarters. It was finished in the early parts of this decade. And yeah, it's another example of how far China is willing, as Sean said before, to lose money for the betterment of other nations. So onto the railway. This is not, in fact, the Tanzanian railway, but it's the Kenyan SGR, which is just 500 kilometers north, and it gives us a good image of what will be coming in Tanzania very soon, because the first part of it will be completed in November. The Dar es Salaam, like this month, it's a bit delayed, but it's coming. It's the Dar es Salaam to Mwanza route, which will also link with Kigali, the capital of Rwanda, and also Burundi. The route in total is roughly 1,800 kilometers long and will link the majority of East African nations alongside Kenya and Uganda's SGR project, which will run parallel to this line just some 500 kilometers or so north, eventually creating a U-shaped line passing through five nations. Again, this line is part of China's Grand Belt and Road Initiative and is helped with funding from China's Exim Bank, as well as the multiple nations' governments. Bear in mind that upon closer research, I found that these loans have very low interest rates and long time frames for repayment, while also being flexible on renegotiation mechanisms. Multiple examples have shown that sometimes nations who have high levels of debt with the World Bank and IMF have had to renegotiate their loans with China because of the stress of paying their Western loans, which have much, much higher interest rates and unfavorable conditions, such as austerity measures which are forced to be undertaken to meet monthly payments. The line, again, though funded largely by China, is in fact being built by two companies outside of China, one from Turkey and the other from Portugal. Yapı Merkezi is from Turkey, and they are cooperating with Motor Engil Africa from Portugal. They have a permanent representation in Africa with their Motor Engil Africa unit. This goes to show that though the credit is supplied by China, it is not conditional that the project is built by Chinese companies. This line, much like Kenya's already in part completed SGR, will provide the populations of these nations with much needed transport access at extremely low costs. For example, having ridden the SGR in Kenya twice myself with my partner Julia when we go there to work with the children, I experienced the cheapest train ticket for a 500 kilometer journey ever in my life at an amazing $8 for a one-way ticket. Tanzania's line will replicate these prices, so it is said by the government, and even better still, instead of being a diesel locomotive, which is what the Kenyan government is currently using due to energy shortages, which will be solved when GERD comes online, Tanzania's trains will be electric and they will run at around 160 kilometers an hour, which is faster than a lot of British trains. People from all classes, when we were boarding the trains, people from all classes were boarding the trains, and when I spoke to the locals, everyone said how pleased they were with the new SGR and how it had radically changed their lives. Visiting family and friends became an hourly commute rather than a full day trip by car, and a dangerous trip, not to mention, and the operation of businesses and transportation of goods has increased the economy by reducing the cost of transportation by a third. And in already just 2 years of operation, has increased the economy by an approximate 1.8%. That's just for Kenya. When you combine both of these lines together, and when they will soon be linked, just imagine what it will do for the growth of jobs and interconnectivity in the region. People from far and wide, when visiting these wonderful nations, will be able to ride aboard modern trains and view the vast savannah from the comforts of their seat while enjoying a tasty lunch and a rich conversation with locals about their culture and nature. I, for one, was astounded to pass through places of serene beauty, viewing all the giraffes, elephants, lions, ostriches, zebras, and so on, who peacefully coexisted with the lion, given that the government did in fact take due care to build bridges over the national parks so as not to interfere with migration routes of the wildlife. This is the prosperity such grand infrastructure building and reforms can bring, and I have only spoken of two projects in detail today. In reality, I am currently documenting over 160 major transportation projects being built on the continent as we speak, most having completion dates set before 2025. That's just transport, like not energy, not water, just trains, roads, airports. I haven't even had time to mention the countless SEZs that are being built alongside these train lines, as well as in Ethiopia, Nigeria, Ivory Coast, and Egypt. Let me show you some of these projects now, which actually, in fact, I didn't have time to do, but I'm just gonna talk about these images here. So here we have, this is the SGR in Kenya. This is the bridge that they built over Tsavo National Park, because of course, and with good reason, conservationists and environmentalists kicked up a major stink about a train passing through migration routes. And it is essential that those routes are kept open and that the animals can pass, because as we know, it is the greatest migration that happens on the planet. So yeah, they built a 7-kilometer bridge through Tsavo East National Park, which on the map is around about here. And as you pass on this bridge, like, you can see how high up you are, you see everything. Like, it's a savannah, so it's totally flat, and you can see elephants and lions and all kinds of wonderful things, like, from really far away, and it costs you $8, rather than paying a private guide to take you into the park for about $250 a day. So yeah, you can see that now. Also, many people in Kenya would before have not had access to those national parks because they've been privatized and that they're so expensive. Now they just take an $8 train trip and voila. So just to move on to another image here, that's the Dzara, which, as you can see, is still working and functioning perfectly well, which was built in 1970 and finished in 75. They are rehabilitating it as we speak. It's 1,800 kilometers, so it's going to be quite expensive. But China has provided a lot of materials and expertise in that field, and they've even set up training centers within Tanzania and Rwanda, Zambia, all of these countries, to train young. And when I say young, I mean we have to remember Africa's population is the youngest population in the world by a percentage. Around 80% of their population is below the age of 30. And it's growing at the fastest rate as well, so it is absolutely imperative that projects like these are rehabilitated and that the youth of Africa is used to work on it, to gain skills, to of course get a living wage so that they can have a family, so that they can live a good and honest life. And thereafter, it will boost the economy, it will boost consumption, it will boost the research and development of each nation, and at some point they won't be reliant on China to be teaching them. They'll be able to step forth into new technologies and science by themselves. So just to move on to the next slide, this is something else we haven't seen before in Africa. Like, now finally, after all this time, because of China's Belt and Road Initiative and other loans that are provided by India and Japan, what you see here is the nations are actually coordinating with each other how to build these lines, which are going to help alleviate poverty by providing tens of thousands of jobs. And in those brand new headquarters that are based in Addis Ababa, which was funded by China, they are coordinating their actions together in infrastructure building so that they can find the best and most efficient routes by which they can connect their countries. So this is not complete yet, but this line here is currently being built. This line here, as of just last month, is finished up until there. And my partner and I have ridden on this section, and it functions without delay, and it's extremely cheap. And in also my own personal experience, everybody working there, bar five individuals, is Kenyan. Of course, there are Chinese operators who are still training them how to take care of the service, how to do the maintenance, how to do the signaling systems. When you're running a train, of course, you're transporting thousands of people, so you have to make sure that security is implemented and that the lives of those people is safe. And it's a single gauge rail line, so you've got, it's not like what you are used to in most Western countries where you have two tracks. The trains pass each other side by side. In Kenya, they didn't have the money to build two tracks, so they've built a single one for now, where at different intervals, the trains actually have to go into these sections where there's six rail lines, and they pass each other. So the timing and the coordination of the timing when the trains pass each other has to be down to the minute. Like, it has to be perfectly done. So that's why the Chinese have to remain there for now, at least for the next 5 years, to train people, like, to not have two trains basically crash head-on into each other. Because, of course, then the Western media would jump on that, and the scorn would come flowing like a wave. But yeah, this is the actual plan. And you've got the purple existing rail lines and then planned and under construction. And on the right there, the picture is a picture from the Schiller Institute about what Africa can and will be in 2050, especially with China's help and India and Japan, as I said. But also now, just to mention, it's come to my attention that America just recently signed a deal with Mozambique, which is down here for anybody who doesn't know, to build a gas-powered station at the cost of $5 billion through America's Exim Bank, Export-Import Bank.
$5 million or billion?
$5 billion. Well, Donald Trump doesn't do. He doesn't do small measures, you know. And he's obviously gone for a big thing, like, straight off. And it was, like, I can say, like, it was personally administered by him, and he did have oversight over it. As at least that's what's reported. And he has stated that America wants to play a more constructive role on the continent instead of just providing aid. He's actually shutting down a lot of aid programs because he considers them to be a waste of time, which they are. As you saw with Band-Aid and We Are the World, like, providing aid to a continent of 1.2 billion people has all the effect of giving a dollar to a tramp on the street here. You're just basically continuing the same problem. You're not actually making anything any better. What would be making it better is taking the tramp off the street, giving him a job, giving him the wage that he can go home and live a normal life. That would be a start. So the same applies to nations. Like, if you're going to get them off the ground and get and hit the ground running instead of crawling out of dust, you need to provide billions. And we're talking about the largest continent in the world here, so it's no small measure. But what we've learned from China, and thanks to Sean's presentation, what you saw after on that video, which if we want to go back and watch it, because it was brilliant, just to get an idea of what happened after 1978, their GDP sped up, like, incredibly. I said to Julio when we were watching it, like, watch what happens when Deng Xiaoping comes to the fore, and his economic reforms changed China like we'd never seen before. Like, it was growing, yeah, okay, it was at the same rate as India. Where's India now? So we can look at those two systems and make direct comparisons. India is the largest democracy on the planet. China is authoritarian. And okay, some people who are liberal would say, in their right mind, they would always pick a democracy. But if we talk about results, like statistical results, there is no comparison. China raised 800 million people out of poverty, and that's World Bank statistics. India is only just starting to defeat poverty. Like, they still have rampant inequality in India. It's really hard to control. Like, they are struggling. The government, Modi, right now is struggling with warring factions in his country. Whereas China, you know, is way past that. They're already implementing 6G. They're already talking about a 1,000-kilometer maglev line, and it's going to be started to be being built next year. Like, next year, a magnetically levitating train is going to start to be being built in China. India hasn't got a high-speed train yet. But in 1978, their economies were basically, yeah, they were the same. In that video, what I saw is that they were on the same level. And then at some point, under those economic reforms of Deng Xiaoping, China ran away with the gold medal. And they did it every Olympics since then as well. And that just goes to show, like, when you provide, like Lyndon LaRouge says in his Four Laws, when you provide credit-stimulated investment, not money, not aid, not charity, like credit in the form of loans with low interest and long repayment schemes, you can have that. Because it's not essential that all the money gets paid back. That's, who cares? At the end of the day, what is an economy? Like, if people are not escaping poverty, who cares how big America's stock market is? At the end of the day, you still have, like, 1 in 4 children, like, growing up in poverty in America today. Like, you can still, as far as you get ahead, you can still go back on yourself. If you don't, if you become complacent and stop worrying about the standards of living of people, which, thank God for China that they haven't, you will fall back into a dark age, and that's what the West is experiencing now. And I firmly believe that if we're going to have another renaissance on this planet, it will start in the African continent. China has provided the impetus, but given that this is the largest continent on the planet, and still, like, we gave a talk the other day, like, still they don't have artistic institutions, they don't have cultural foundations, they don't have theatres, they don't have many of the things that we take for granted. Most streets that you walk down don't have a pavement. And a lot of people will go there and be like, oh God, that's so negative, it's so depressing. But it's not. Like, it's a huge opportunity. 80% of the population is under the age of 30. Like, get them working. Put a hammer in their hand and pay them and train them how to build these things, because the time is now, and China is pushing it alone, and we could all jump on board that train to success and prosperity. Thank you, everyone, for listening to me today, and till the next time.